Hey everybody, welcome back to the video tutorial series. Today I'm going to share 10 tips for editing in Adobe Lightroom, and these tips are geared towards underwater photographers, but can apply to any sort of photo you're shooting, as long as you're editing in Adobe Lightroom. Some of these powerful features, almost hidden features, will help speed up your workflow and help you edit better images. So with that said, you know, let's dive in, let's see what these tips are. And number one, this is lens corrections. And when I'm editing, I'll always try to apply the biggest global changes and then go into the smaller global changes into some of the local area changes. So from the stuff that will make the biggest impact in the photo to the most minute, subtlest impact in the photo. And the first thing I'll always look at is lens corrections. And what lens corrections does is it corrects for barrel distortion and vignetting, you know, darkness around the edges of the frame of the image. And it'll also tend to flatten the image a little bit if it's got more of a more distortion inherent at, let's say, a shorter focal range. So this is a powerful feature for underwater photographers, for both macro, wide angle, or anything else you're shooting. So let's look at exactly how that's going to work. Applying the lens corrections is really easy. You want to be in the develop module of Adobe Lightroom and look at the right-hand panel and scroll all the way towards the bottom to lens corrections. So make sure to open up lens corrections. And you'll notice that you have two checkmark boxes here. Remove chromatic aberration. I always turn that on. You'll see a lot more of that color around the fringes of high contrast areas in compact cameras and things like that. It's a little less apparent in DSLRs and higher end cameras. Anyways, always click that. But enable profile corrections. Watch what's going to happen as I click this button. Boom, we saw a lot more color around the edges and the edges became brighter, and that's getting rid of that vignetting and that barrel distortion. You'll also notice that Lightroom Sensei was able to read the camera and the lens I was using for the shot. They did not know I had a fantasy wet lens on top of that 16-50, but hey, you know, they can't know that. But anyways, for the barrel distortion with the 16-50, they corrected for it. So corrections on, corrections off, on, off. So you'll notice that it's a really powerful tool. For all macro, I'll usually turn this on. There will be a lot less barrel distortion in a macro lens, but for something like this, as we go towards the wider angle lens, there will be more distortion, or even a fisheye lens, there will be even more distortion. So this is a really powerful tool. Whether you want to apply it or not, that's going to depend on you, but I tend to always check it regardless to see which I want as a starting point for my editing. Number two, auto tone. So this is a great feature in Adobe Lightroom, more for the beginners. If you've just gotten Lightroom and you're trying to figure out what kind of adjustments do I need, how do I make my kind of bland grayish raw file into a sharp, vibrant JPEG? Auto tone will help you do that. So basically this will use Adobe Sensei, their algorithm for determining how to make your image look as good as possible, and give you a suggestion. What I like to think of it as a starting point for your editing. And I'll have my own custom presets for it, and once you get used to Lightroom, you'll probably move off of auto tone and move more into your own presets and your own auto tone, your custom auto tones. But to start, if you're curious about an editing starting point, auto tone will do it. Let's check it out. Applying auto tone is really easy. So in the develop module, again, you'll go down to the basic box and look above the basic tone editing sliders, and you'll see this auto right here. Click, boom. You'll see that it added some contrast and made a number of adjustments to add some contrast back into this image that didn't have a lot of contrast to begin with. So I'm gonna hit the slash key before, after, before, after. So we've got a great starting point for our image. Pretty simple. Number three. There's a number of different ways to interact with your sliders, kind of like everything in Adobe Photoshop, Adobe Lightroom. You know, you can make your adjustments in a number of different ways. So let's quickly look at exactly how we can move our sliders around. So we've got our sliders right here. And what we can always do as we're adjusting is double click on the slider right here, double click, and it resets. It goes back to zero. We can click and drag to get the effect we want with the slider. But then we can also type it. If, let's say, I've got it real small here, you know, I'm having trouble getting back to that 0.43 where I was, you know, I'm just going to click and I'm gonna type 0.43, boom. And then I'll get it right to there where I wanted it. One of the other tricks you can do with sliders is to pull out the box, and now I've got a lot more space. So now I might be able to actually get it right to where I want it at 0.43, well, 0.45, 0.43, I'll type, and now I've used the sliders in a number of different ways. Number four, snapshots and resetting. So this is a really powerful tool. I love snapshots anytime I want to save the work that I've done so far and move into something else. So if I've made a number of different changes that are going to be hard to find again, yes, I could go back in the history and try and click on just the right one, but you know, you're looking at 100 different adjustments, you know, good luck finding that point where you left off. What a snapshot does is it takes a snapshot of your editing at that moment in time. You can call it anything you want, and then you can go ahead and make any changes you want. You can even reset, start from scratch, re-edit your photo, and always find that snapshot, which is that point you left off in the image. So let's look at how to do that. So here's our image inside the develop module of Lightroom, and we've got the edits. Here's what I've done so far in this image. Pretty basic, but we want to save it, and I'm going to experiment some more. So what I'm going to do is go to the left panel, and I'll see snapshots, add, and it defaults to date and time, which is pretty convenient, but not always. So why don't I call that finished edit one, and I've created the snapshot. So now with confidence, I can go and start tweaking some of these other adjustments here. And now I'm doing all these edits, and I'm experimenting, and I'm grabbing that tone curve, and I'm doing all these things. And you know what? Shoot, I just don't like this. How do I go back, you know, to where I was? If I look at history, oh goodness, like that's just too much going on there. Finished edit. Let me just click my snapshot and I'm back exactly to where I was. And this is useful too if you want to experiment with this edit as well. And I'm going to start over. You know what? Here we go. I've taken away all my edits. This is a file straight out of camera. And I'm going to start experimenting. Let's see if I can get back to where I was a little bit, you know, with my edit. And you know, what I had before was great. I'm going to give up on this one. You know, I don't like the direction I'm going with this. Let's go back to what was my finished edit. And as soon as that loads, boom, that was the edit I had before that I really liked. So snapshots, really powerful tool and a great tip. Number five, that was fancy, right? This is before and after. And as you're editing, it's easy to go down a rabbit hole of applying too much editing. Maybe it's too much color and saturation. Maybe it's way too much contrast or something like that. So looking at before and after will help you determine, hey, I'm making the right amount of edits. Look at the progress I'm making towards a vibrant image with more pop, but you know, making sure I'm not going overboard too. So before and after is a powerful tool just to see the edits you've made so far and where, what direction you want to take your editing in. Looking at our photo in the develop module, just hit the backslash key on your keyboard. Before, after, before, after. You can also come down here, hit this double Y, and you can see before and after here. Hit tab. You'll get rid of those side panels, and now you can see the before and the after. There's also a number of other ways you can check out before and after views, so feel free to experiment around with those. Number six, lights out. This is a really cool feature as you're getting towards the end of your editing process, and lights out is basically what it says, is it turns the lights out. It gets rid of all the clutter around the image. And you can basically get rid of the panels in Adobe Lightroom to look at the image exactly how you'd like to view it, whether it's a black background, a white background, or some sort of grayscale in between. And it's great just to see how your photo is going to appear, whether it's in social media, on your website, or anywhere else you might share it without distracting panels on the side. So a really powerful feature. All you need to do is hit the L key on your keyboard. And you'll see here we've got a slightly opaque black background, and here we have a jet black background. So now we can see our image without any distractions, which is really useful when you're starting to look at the final product. What you can also do is go to Lightroom Preferences and go to the Interface tab, and you'll see here Lights Out. You can choose a screen color, black, dark gray, medium, light gray, white, depending on your website or where you're gonna host it. So if your website has a white background theme, maybe you want to preview lights out with white instead of black, or maybe you just want a gray. You can also choose this dim level or the opacity on what you want. The default here is black 80%. That works for me, but it's cool to be able to customize it. And number seven is to watch the clipping. So basically, clipping is where the blacks on the far left of the histogram or the whites on the far right of the histogram can get clipped. And when that happens, your pixels have no data in them. So it's possible to do that in camera if you're shooting way underexposed or way overexposed. But editing, you can also start clipping the shadows, the blacks, or clipping the highlights, the whites, in the histogram. So by toggling clipping on and off, we can see when we're starting to lose the detail in those pixels on the black side or the white side, and take our editing from there. You can view the clipping in a number of different ways. The easiest to turn clipping on and off, to toggle it on and off, is to hit the J key on your keyboard. And watch these arrows at the top of the histogram. I'm going to hit J, and you see they're illuminated now, and we can see blue clipping in the blacks, and around the eye we can see some red clipping in the whites, the highlights. So I hit J, it turns off again. J turns it back on. You can also turn on either one or the other, so I'll manually click the black clipping highlight, black clipping alert, that's a tongue twister, or you can click the whites and the highlights clipping alert. There you go. You can also just hover the mouse and you'll see that red pop up, or hover, you'll see the blue pop up. So a lot of different ways you can look at the clipping. And number 8, the white balance selector tool. So this is a really, really powerful tool, and when you have a powerful tool, you need to be careful to moderate it. Too much power can be too tempting to create too drastic of changes. So I like to use this white balance tool only on occasion. It just depends. And everyone who has a different camera and strobe setup is going to have slightly different color, especially while using auto white balance, which generally I'll always suggest unless you're doing video. But what this does is it allows us to make subtle changes to the white balance of the photo. But it can be too powerful, because if you do too much adjustment, you're going to start to see a red tint in the image, especially towards the higher area of the water column when shooting wide angle. Some of the sun rays come down, might pick up a lot of red hue, which doesn't look great. So let's look at exactly how to use the white balance selector tool and not go overboard. So here's our image from before, the one where we used the auto tone to help create some edits in the image. And what we're going to do now is take this white balance selector tool, and you want to look for a neutral place. Generally, it's going to be a piece of white that has some ambient light coming through, or light from your strobes or your video lights. And we pick this neutral target, we're going to click it, and now you'll see that white balance came through. We got a lot more grays and things in the image, but we have a lot more red going on here. So let's look at the before and after. Boom. So you can see that we added a lot of color here in the grays, made it more of a true color, if you will. You know, we can use red filters to do that sort of thing, but now we've got this red, and that's what I'm talking about. You know, with great power comes great responsibility. So that's a little bit of red. What you can do now in this sort of image is adjust the temperature and the tint a little bit to try and make the effects a little more subtle. And if you subscribe to my video series, you'll see I did a entire photo edit that's 15 minutes on exactly how I would edit this photo with great color and some of the other settings. So definitely check that out if you haven't yet. The white balance selector tool is certainly a piece of it. And number 9, here's where we get towards the end and some of the really exciting stuff. So this is star ratings in Adobe Lightroom. So we rank our photos, we rate them, and this is an effort to be able to find the photo later, because when you apply a star ranking system from 1 to 5, you can go through and search later on, and let's say I don't want my photos that aren't that great, the 0 stars, the 1 stars, the 2 stars, boom, click 3 star, and here we go. Now we've got all the 3 star and above, some of our better images from the shoot. So let's see exactly how we're doing that. And here's our photo, and you'll notice down below it that we have the toolbar visible. If it's not visible, go to View and Toolbar. You'll say Show Toolbar, and then you'll see this toolbar, and here we have a number of different criteria. You can flag pics, flag for deletion, and stars. Boom, that's it. 3, 4, whatever you want. You can add a color system if you want. I'll generally use stars as the primary ranking system, and then I'll have colors to indicate various other things. And the beauty of this is that you can go to library mode, you can hit Command F or Control F, and now check this out. No searching for that reef, but we can search based on a number of different attributes here, based on text in our metadata. We can look at all these different criteria here, so I can search for 3 stars and above and go from there. So really powerful feature. And number 10, our final tip for today, is creating collections in Lightroom. And we know that Lightroom is a non-destructive editing tool, and it does everything virtually. You've got your raw file here, and then all the edits take place in a virtual layer on top, so you're never hurting the original raw file, which is the beauty of this. You can always go back to a starting point. If you're editing in Adobe Photoshop without the original file saved, and you save over with those changes, bye-bye first level of changes. You're now stuck with that edited product. In Lightroom, you can always go back to the starting point, which is great. And with collections, what we do is we can arrange the photos based on any criteria without moving the original file structure. So all of our raw files will stay in that format, whether it's folders organized by year and then location, or whatever system you use. And then we can organize the rest of our photos by certain marine life, certain locations, certain colors, maybe wide angle or macro, maybe certain techniques like portraits or behavior, things like that. So collections are a really powerful tool. Let's quickly look at how we can use collections. In case you didn't notice yet, I've been looking at just four photos inside Lightroom, and how do I have these four random photos just sitting here? Well, I've actually got them in a collection. So inside the library or the develop module, just go to the left panel, open up collections, and here's where you'll add a number of collections. So I've got tutorials, and right here I've got my 10 tips tutorials, and I've got my four photos I picked from all of my other catalog and added them in here. So one of the cool things you can do is, as you're searching around, I'll say, okay, I found this image. What I want to do is create a collection of all my Garibaldi photos. So you'll simply select a photo, you'll hit the plus sign, you'll say create collection. And what I'm going to do is leave it inside my tutorials collection set, and I'm going to say Garibaldi photos. And now what I do is hit create. And now I've got this nice collection of Garibaldi photos. Again, because it's a virtual, I didn't move the photo from where I originally had it. It is now in this virtual collection called Garibaldi, and I can go through all of my folders, all my archives, and move all my favorite Garibaldi folders into this collection. So I also have a dedicated tutorial coming on using collections and setting up target collections and ways to make this more efficient and quicker. So be sure to stay tuned and subscribe, and you'll get all the secrets with collections coming soon. And there we have it. Those are our 10 tips for editing photos in Adobe Lightroom. I hope you found those useful. If you have any questions, always feel free to email me, brent@brentdurand.com. I hope you're subscribed to the video tutorial series at video.brentdurand.com. We've got a lot of exclusive videos in that series. But you can also check out my tutorial website for written tutorials, gear guides, and a lot of other cool stuff. That's at tutorials.brentdurand.com. And feel free, send me your questions, send me your thoughts. If you want to see how I would edit one of your images, go ahead, email that to me. I'll make a video for you and give you access to that video. So a lot of great stuff going on. Highly encourage you to get in touch, to snoop around the website, check out all the tutorials there, and hope that this inspires you to keep shooting a lot and take your underwater photography to the next level. So once again, Brent Durand, and look forward to seeing you on the next video. Thanks, guys.